Hi, it's Mr. Andersen, and this is Crosscutting Concept 3. It's on scale, proportion, and quantity. And so it's really letting our kids understand the difference between really big and really small. And that's important, the sense of scale, because in science it allows us to understand phenomena at different scales. And in engineering it's really important. So a scale model, for example, or a sense of scale in a design is super important. And so let me give you an example of this. This right here is a sea star. You might think of it as a starfish. And if you look at it when you're snorkeling or scuba diving, it seems really boring. It's just sitting there. And the reason why is that they move incredibly slow. And so if you're to film them with a time-lapse camera, all of a sudden life jumps into action. They're going to move around, they're going to fight, they're going to eat, they're going to defend territory, and we can't see that. They just look like they're sitting there kind of boring because we don't have a sense of their time scale. If we were to look at this laser beam right here, how fast light is, or even what a photon is, it's hard for us to wrap our head around that because it's so fast. But other things like a mountain seems permanent because we don't realize how slowly it moves or even how big it is and the forces that move it are. And if we're talking about big, we could get no bigger than the universe itself. So this idea that the whole universe at singularity before the Big Bang was less than the size of a period in a sentence is crazy. But we really have to understand this sense of scale before we can really understand phenomena. In other words, for science to work. And so basically there are three continuums. We have the continuum of size. Things can be incredibly big or incredibly small. We've got this idea of time span. In other words, it can be a really long period of time or incredibly short period of time. And then we have huge amounts of energy or no amounts of energy. And so if we're talking about a proton, for example, it's going to be incredibly small, have a really tiny amount of energy, and it's going to exist or it's going to operate on a really small time span. But something like continental drift is going to be massive in size, huge amounts of energy, and it's going to take a long period of time for that to occur. And so to summarize, we basically got human scale, what we can see and deal with, you know, just with our hands and with our eyes. We have those things that are really small and really fast and things that are too large or too slow for us to observe. And so to give you an idea of the power of sense of scale, let's look at a snowflake. This is a snowflake that's we've taken a picture of it using an electron microscope. Looks gorgeous, but if we were to just see that without a sense of scale, we wouldn't know anything. But now there's a scale bar down here on the bottom, and so it's saying that this from here to here is 1 millimeter. And that's basically how far you can hold your fingers apart without letting them touch. And so that's really small. But as we zoom in with an electron microscope, we can see more detail and more detail. But if I didn't have a sense of scale, if I didn't know that this now is 0.05 millimeters, or as we move closer and closer and closer, now we're getting to micrometers, then I really wouldn't know what I was looking at. And so it's important in science that we have a sense of scale. Because when we get into this level, at this really small level, it's important that we really know what we're looking at. And that scale is going to be important. In other words, we're going to have meaningful concepts at different levels of scale. And so if you were to touch a piece of wood or a nail or to hammer a nail into wood, you would say these are solid. In other words, wood is solid. If I knock on wood, it sure seems solid. But if we were to move our scale down to the very small, if we were to get down to the level of electrons and electron clouds of probability, being a solid is really doesn't mean anything. In fact, when I put my hands on this table or put my hands together, they're not really touching. It's not solids in contact. It's the electrons kind of hovering and interacting on top of each other. And so as we get into this really zoomed in scale, it's important that we know what are the meaningful concepts at each level. And so a powerful tool that we can use in science is the idea of proportion. It allows us to wrap our head around these differences in scale. And so you can think of proportion as a ratio. In other words, a ratio of quantity A to quantity B. In other words, it's a fraction. And when I say the word fraction, you tend to think of something like this, parts of a whole. In other words, this piece of the pie is 7% of the pie. And that's really important that we understand a ratio as that. But ratios are way more powerful than that, because a ratio could also allow us to move between different units. In other words, velocity is going to be change in position over a change in time, and that's a proportion, but it's allowing us to move between different scales, or density as well as a proportion. And so it's important that we understand that a scale doesn't have to be distance over distance or unit over unit. It can be different units as well. So this quantity and the understanding the units is super important as well. So what's the goal? We want our students to be able to sense scale and understand scale. And so we want them to understand relative scales. We then want them to understand quantities, and we'll use units of measure to get to that. But finally, we want to understand this idea of proportion and ratio. And so as we move from middle school into high school, the power of estimation is important, and then mathematical modeling is important as well. So what's the progression? In other words, how do you start doing this in kindergarten and then progress through high school? In other words, how do you start throwing darts at the dartboard from the beginning but get better and better and closer to the bullseye over time? Well, how do you do this in an early elementary class? You could do it as simply as this. And so we've got these four pictures of organisms right here. Could you have your students classify them according to speed, which is going to be the slowest, and what's going to be the fastest? Well, slowest, I would say, is probably going to be the sunflower. Then maybe the snail, then the whale, and then probably the falcon. Could you classify them according to size scale? Which one's going to be the smallest? Which one's going to be the biggest? Or what about lifespan? Could you put it in lifespan from the smallest lifespan to the greatest? The students should be able to figure out or take a stab at it. I learned this, that the sunflower, I knew the sunflowers are obviously only going to live 1 year, but snails will live like 5 to 7 years. And so I would put them next, then the bird, and then the whale. And so have them sensing scale from the beginning. But then we want to move into units of measure. And when you're teaching scale, the one that you want to begin with is length. So you want to have a really good understanding as we move through elementary of length. But once we have length and units of length, we always try to use the meter system if we can, or the metric system if we can, then we move towards weight, time, and then temperature. And so we want to be using units. So we're measuring what the quantity is, but we also want to have, what is that quantity measuring? Is it a distance? Is it time? And it's really important when you're doing science that you have a unit of measure that goes along with that quantity that we actually measured. As we move forward, estimation becomes important. So how many kernels of corn are in here? I don't really know the right answer, but we could use estimation to figure it out. In other words, if it's uniform throughout, we could figure out how many are in there. And so estimation is important, and then understanding the powers of 10 is important. So what is the powers of 10? Well, basically, if this little dot right here represents 1 or 10 to the 0, then this right here is 10 to the 9, or this is 1 billion of those little dots. And so this gives you a sense of scale of the powers of 10, and you want to give them that power. You want to have students estimating and then understanding the power of 10 and why we use a base 10 system. And then as you move up greater, we really want to do mathematical modeling of observed phenomena. And so this is something I used to do in my class. Basically, when I was getting at units of measure and the power of graphing, what I would say is choose 10 objects in the room. They all have to be a circle. And I want you to measure what their circumference is, and I want to measure what their diameter is. And so just gather some data, but be as precise as you can. And then when you're done, I want you to graph the data. So we have circumference on the y, and then we have the diameter on the x. And what you'll find is if we graph circumference over diameter, we're going to get a linear relationship. But now we're going to get a line, and if you ask them to calculate the line of that, you're going to find that that's around 3. In other words, it's around 3.14. So the slope is important. And so basically what I'm showing them is that we can have different senses of scale, we can gather data, but we can make predictions from that data. In other words, we could extend this out and figure out other things. Also, we want to get into the importance of linear versus exponential growth. And they will have seen these things in their math class. But this is an interesting picture. What we've got here is basically a linear relationship. That's going to be in red. We've got a cube relationship. And then we've got this exponential relationship right here, where we're actually putting x up here in the exponent. And what we'll find is that exponential growth is going to outpace the other two. And exponential growth and the importance of that is super important in biology because it shows how bacteria grow. They're going to grow exponentially. One makes two, makes four, and so we're going to have a huge amount of growth. And that gives us fast growth, small things growing really, really quickly, another sense of scale. And so scale is important. We use proportions as a tool and units of measure to get at that. And I hope this was helpful.